Martha Nicholson says this in a little poem called Treasures. She says, "One by one, God took them from me. All things I valued most, till I was empty-handed. Every glittering toy was lost, and I walked Earth's highway, grieving in my rags and poverty, until I heard his voice inviting me, 'Lift those empty hands to me.' And I turned my hands towards heaven, and he filled them with a store of his own transcendent riches, till I could contain them no more. And at last I was able to understand that God could not pour his riches into hands already full." I wonder if our hands are full tonight, full of the cares of this world, full of anxiety, full of issues with our jobs and our kids and our relationships, issues about the future, so much so that just maybe God can't pour into us, into our hands, because they're full of so many things. So my prayer tonight is that we would freely give Jesus all of our things so that he can freely give us all of the things that he would want us to have. I was thinking of a picture of those acrobats that hold plates and all kinds of stuff on. They're all contorted. They have plates here and plates here and plates on their heads. I wonder if that's a picture of us. So many things we're holding on to, so many things that are in our hands that God says, "You know what? I hear you're praying, but where can I put all of these things that I want to give you? Because it seems that you're too busy worrying about things. It seems you're too busy pursuing other things." Thus, my prayer tonight is that our greatest pursuit would be Jesus and him alone. Amen? So turn in your Bibles, if you haven't already, to Philippians chapter 3. We're going to look at verses 14 through 21, hopefully, if time permits. Philippians chapter 3, starting at verse 14. Everybody there? All right. It says this. Paul says, "I press towards the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, let us, as many as are mature, let us have this mind. And if anything you think otherwise, God will reveal even this to you. Nevertheless, to the degree that we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule. Let us be of the same mind. Brethren, join in following my example, and note those who so walk, as you have us for a pattern. For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you, even weeping, that they are enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who set their mind on earthly things." Verse 20, "For our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, whom will transform our lowly body, that it may be conformed to his glorious body, according to the working by which he is able even to subdue all things to himself." What a great chapter. Let's pick up where we were last week. We remember we talked about Paul's faith. We talked about his hope in Jesus, his mindset, his direction. We're going to pick up with his focus in verse 14. That he says, "I press toward the goal of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." I love the words that I'm pressing towards something, that he's working towards getting closer to Jesus Christ. That having a relationship with Jesus, it's not just going to happen by us just standing idle. Paul is saying that I press towards the goal of the prize of the upward call. So I guess the question is, how do we press towards the goal of the prize of Christ Jesus? We do what we're doing here tonight. We sung some worship songs. We're going to pray after service is over. We're going to read our Bibles as we're doing right now. We can fellowship with one another. We can read our Bibles. We can volunteer. And as we do all of these things, we're taking a step closer and closer to Jesus Christ because we're becoming servants. We're walking closer towards Him. We're loving on one another and having fellowship with one another because God has a purpose and a call for each and every one of us. Paul wants us to focus on Jesus, and not only on Jesus, but also on the future that we have with Him. He tells this to 2 Timothy. He says, "Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on the day, and not only to me only, but to all those who loved His appearing." I am so inspired by Paul because his focus is always Jesus Christ. His love for the Lord is always passionate. It's never lukewarm. And I've told you many times that the greater we love Jesus Christ, the greater lovers we're going to be of each other, the greater fathers, the husbands and boyfriends and girlfriends, the closer we are to Jesus Christ, the better we will be to each other. My son and I were having a conversation about Gandhi, and I think Gandhi made a quote that he loves our Christ, but not so much our Christians. And I wonder if we as believers would, to be a Christian is to be a little Christ. Did you know that? It's to be an imitator of Christ. That if we as believers would be imitators of Christ in love, in deed, in action, and in speech, I seriously believe that we would turn this world upside down for Christ. But it has to start with our pursuits. That it's this upward call that Paul is talking about, that it's a high calling that comes from above. A commentator named Myers says that this emanated from the heart of God, this high calling from God is because God is worthy, and that this idea has come from the heart of God, and it summons us to be seated where Christ is at the right hand. And it this calling is to draw us nearer to God, that He's calling us out from where we are. He's calling us from self unto Him. Now that's where the problem starts, is He's calling us to be greater than self, to put self second. But every one of us, we woke up this morning, the first thing we thought about is, what am I going to wear? Because we wanted to look good this morning, right? No one walked out of the house with things all unironed and wrinkled and all kinds of dirty clothes. You got up saying, you know what? I'm going to put on something nice today so I can look nice. And some of you ladies put a little shh, because you're thinking about how you're going to smell, right? We're thinking about ourselves, and that's a good thing to make sure you smell good. But we're thinking about ourselves when we wake up in the morning. Before we go to bed, we're going to think about ourselves. But this upward call of God in Christ Jesus, we need to be more mindful about our pursuit of Christ, not just our pursuit of these things here on earth. Well, Paul goes on to talk about his mind. Psalm 25, it says, "The humble He guides in justice, and the humble He teaches His way." Verse 15, it says, "Let us, as many as are mature, have this mind, and if anything or otherwise, God will reveal even this to you." What I love about God is that He is in the business of still speaking to us. Have you ever come into a fork in the road with your walk with God? You're like, God, okay, I need You to tell me, do I go this way or do I go this way? And it's a hard decision, isn't it? God, what do I do? So we stop and we pray. We ask God, where should I go? And some of us are waiting for God to say, okay, I want You to take two steps forward, take a step to the left, pause and wait for me, and then I'll tell You further instructions. Sure about you, but God has never spoken to me like that. God has never given me that audible, detailed instructions. But what I have done is I've laid my plan before God, and I said, God, these are the decisions that are before me. I'm not sure what to choose. So we look through God's scripture, we see if our decisions or our plans are in line with God's scriptures, and then we'll say, God, this is the way that I believe You are leading me, and then we simply walk. Because I don't believe God has this path for our lives that's illuminated and fluorescent, and it's a perfect path. I believe God asks us to invite Him in on our lives, and God will guide us and direct us, even though we may not hear an audible voice from Him. Proverbs 3, this is God speaking to us. He says, trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not on your own understanding. But what are we to do? In all our ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct our paths. So that means whenever you have a decision that you're coming up to, acknowledge God in that decision. God, this is what's before me. I want to acknowledge you. And the Bible says that God will direct our paths. It's interesting that Paul says, as many as are mature. As many as are mature. All of us have started out being an immature Christian. And that means when something is said to us that's a little sideways, we get a little bent and we decide to leave the church. Anybody ever been there? A few of you. Because the rest of you are mature, right? When we're immature in Christ, the littlest thing can set us off. But when we're mature in Christ, we know that we're here at church to serve God, to worship God, that we're not here for a certain individual. So Paul is saying that, have this mind that's in you, that to be mature in Christ, to grow. And how do we grow? We study God's word. We press towards the goal of the upward call in Christ Jesus. And if anything otherwise, we think that God will reveal this to us. That means God is always going to guide us and direct us if we would simply invite him in on where we're going in this thing called life. But I wonder if God has been revealing things to you. We've been talking about joy for the last, 2-3 months? How is your joy coming? Are you still struggling with the anxiety and the issues? Or have you found your way to find joy that regardless of what's going on, I can have joy in God? And my prayer for you guys every Wednesday is that we would indeed find this joy. Not that we would just meet for 35 minutes or so and then we'll go home and kind of start the race all over again, but that we would have joy. That God will give us opportunity after opportunity to exercise this. Okay, God, I'm not going to freak out. I'm going to have joy. And as we mature in Christ, I believe we're going to have more of this thing called joy. Because think about this. All of the worrying you did last year, how did that work out for you? Did it change anything for you? But some of you have brought in last year to this year. You worried about it last year. You're worried about it this year. And I wonder if God says, give me all of these things, and I want to give you some joy. My prayer is that you've been finding a little bit of joy in this thing called life. Well, in verse 15, we're going to find out that we are not there yet. Sorry, verse 16, it says, nevertheless, to the degree that we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule, and let us be of the same mind. So where we currently are with our walk with God, that's a good thing. So often we discount where we are with God. So Paul is saying, right where you guys are right now in your walk with God, let us have this same mind. Let us be unified. Let us keep thinking about each other. Let's stay on the same page. Because remember why Paul said that they needed unity, because those were those dogs and the mutilators of the flesh. Those are those that said, you need to be saved by being circumcised. And unless you do A, B, C, or D, you will never find salvation. So Paul is reminding them to be unified, to keep your thinking together with Jesus. And sometimes we need to help each other with our thinking, don't we? Because some of you are a little negative sometimes, aren't you? Oh, no amens for that one, huh? Not everybody out here is positive all the time. Let the sun go behind the clouds and you might be screaming, the sky is falling. So what do? We need to encourage each other and say, brother, sister, it's going to be okay. Don't worry about it. It's not like God is surprised by your day. God is not surprised by what you're going through. So just in case the sun goes behind the clouds for a little bit and it starts to rain just a tiny bit, if you start to freak out, it's okay. Just we need to remind each other, God's got a plan for your life. God is taking you somewhere. Just maybe God is maturing you. For instance, how do we know God is all that we need? Most of us have Kaiser or Blue Shield, right? Most of us drove here in a car. Most of us are going to go home and live in a home for tonight. How do we truly know that God is all we need? Just maybe God sometimes allows a few things to happen to us that we can say, oh yeah, I do need you, God. Oh, yeah, I do need you in this situation because the doctor can't fix this. This person can't fix my finances. this won't fix my relationship. Just maybe God is maturing you. So if you're going through a little bit of something right now, maybe God is stretching you. Maybe God is trying to show you that you need to place your trust in him and not in things. Amen? Paul goes on to say about being unified. All churches are going to go through some issues. No church is perfect, but the church that is unified will endure all of the trials that it is going to go through. And the church at Philippi were definitely going through some trials and tribulations. And Paul says this in the earlier chapters of Philippians. He says, only let your conduct be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent, I may hear of your affairs, that you stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. Striving together. Are we together? I mean, we're here in a room together, but are we really together? On Wednesdays, we've been trying to let you know that we need to do life together. I'm sure you've seen it on the road once in a while. Someone will either run out of gas or they'll get a flat tire in the middle of the intersection, and somebody will pull their car over, and they will help a complete stranger push their car off to the side of the road. I wonder, are we the same way with each other? Are we willing to get behind that car of life and help somebody push the car off to the side of the road? Are we willing to say, I'm willing to be inconvenienced by your phone call at 2 o'clock in the morning? I'm willing to be inconvenienced by, hey, how are you doing tonight? Well, I'm not doing really good. Well, let's come and talk a little bit. We know church is going to start in a second, but let's be inconvenienced by each other to say, I want to be behind your car. I want to push with you. And I pray that we would be more than just Wednesday night. Does that make sense? That we would be the family that we can lean on each other. That we can be this example that the Apostle Paul is going to talk about in verse 17. He says, brethren, join in following my example, and note those who also walk as you have for us a pattern. Having an example, having a pattern is so great. Once in a while, if my car breaks or I'm trying to figure out something, or when I was in school and I was taking this crazy math class, I was able to go on YouTube and I was able to type in finite mathematics and see how someone did it from step to step to step. So I was able to follow an example of how to fix a problem, or if my car breaks, I go to YouTube and I look it up, and I'm able to follow an example. When you have an example, it's really easy to follow. Someone says, yeah, I need to fix this, or I have this problem. Well, here's an example of how it worked for me. Then all we have to do is script it. Boom, 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 boom. Following an example. You want to have a blessed life? Well, here's an example the Bible gives. So if we would simply follow the example, everything should work out fine. The only question is, what kind of example are we going to be? So for instance, if all of us right now were to follow you, where would you lead us? Or if we're to follow you, if we're to follow your example, where would that take us? If we're to follow your example, where would that take us? Would you be the type of brother or sister that would lead us to Christ? Would your lifestyle be the type of pattern that we could follow? Those are real big boots to fill, and the Apostle Paul says it like this. He says, imitate me just as I also imitate Christ. I'm not there yet. Man, I want to be there. Paul is saying, just get right in line after me, because I'm following Jesus. That if you follow me, I'm going to lead you right to Jesus. Could we all say that tonight? Follow me as I follow Christ. Not only follow me, but imitate me. Do what I do as I imitate what Jesus has done. I mean, that's a big calling. My prayer is that we would all do our best to imitate Christ. Now, what's great about imitating somebody, you just have to watch what they do and then do it. So are we willing to imitate Christ? Are we willing to imitate Christ when it comes to forgiving other people? Uh-oh. We're willing to imitate Christ when it's maybe loving on people. But maybe when it comes to the hard things, are we willing to imitate Christ at the difficult things? Because we can follow God when he's, you know, blessing people and passing out bread. You know, we can all do that. But what about when someone betrays you? What about when someone talks about you? What about when someone lies about you? Are we willing to imitate Christ and forgive them 70 times 7? I wonder. God, help us to be imitators of Jesus Christ. 1 Thessalonians, Paul goes on to say, "And you became followers of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much affliction with joy of the Holy Spirit." How many of us would say, "Follow me right now in poor health, my job is horrible, or I just lost my job, I may be losing my house, my relationship's not going too well, but follow me as I follow Christ"? Would your example be godly? If we were to follow you right now in your trials and tribulations, where would that path lead us? If we were to follow you right now. Because Paul told the church that you became followers of us in much affliction. So things weren't going good. Things were going bad, but they were still willing to follow Paul. And I pray that we can be that type of example, that people can follow us as we follow Christ, even during bad times. Personally, there's nothing like seeing someone grow in their walk with Christ when they're going through difficult situations. Not that you enjoy what they're going through, but you know that God is doing something in and through them. That if our lives are always wonderful and great, if we never experience any trials or tribulations, we must have to ask ourselves, am I growing closer to Jesus Christ? But that doesn't mean your life needs to be falling apart and you need to rejoice over that. But what I'm saying is, when we go through difficult situations and difficult times, God is drawing us closer to Him. He's teaching us something. And if God is teaching us something, that means He is aware of what we're going through. And if He's aware of what we're going through, that means He has a plan and a purpose for what we're going through. The Apostle Paul knew that. That's why he says, "Hey, follow me as I follow Christ. Imitate me as I imitate Christ." He tells this to Timothy. He says, "Let no one despise your youth." What does he say here? "Be an example to the believers in word, in conduct, in love, in spirit, in faith, and in purity." How are we doing with that? Being an example. How are we all doing with being an example in word? How are your words doing? Flying off the handle? Are they words of encouragement? Are they words to build up, to nurture, to restore, to renew, to encourage, to draw closer to Jesus? How are you doing in your conduct, that personal life? What about your love? Are you showing love to others that someone can say, "I want to love like that guy loves," or "I want to love like that girl loves"? They seem to have a love for the people of God. That means we have to stop thinking about self and start loving others. What about in faith? Is our faith an example to others that say, "Man, that brother, that sister, man, they're growing. They're growing in their faith. They're talking about Jesus." And then impurity. That's a toughie, isn't it? Impurity. But we should be an example in purity also. So I pray that we are all on our journey with being an example. At least I hope so. We're going to move on. And Paul's going to talk about a serious concern that he has for the church. Look at verse 18. He says, "For many of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who set their mind on earthly things." I love Paul because he tells it just like it is. He's passionate and he loves the church at Philippi. It's interesting, he says, "I tell you these things, even weeping." Like, wait a minute, Paul, you've been beaten, stoned, whipped, shipwrecked, left for dead, but yet this is causing you to weep. Why is this causing you to weep, those whose God is their belly and whose glory is in their shame? Another version says this scripture like this. It says the way they live is leading them to destruction. They have replaced God with their own desires. They do shameful things, and they are proud of what they do. They think only about earthly things. This is grieving Paul that they are thinking about themselves. They replace God with their own desires. The Bible seems to be a timeless book. No matter where you open the Bible, it seems like it's talking about today, 2015, that we've replaced God with our own desires. Maybe even think of your own lives tonight. Have you replaced God with your own desires? My father-in-law, I've not known him to say too many things that have been real poignant or real thought-provoking, but my mother-in-law passed away two weeks ago, and after she passed away, he says, kind of just speaking out loud a couple things, he says, you know, don't worry about the money. You know, don't worry about these things that don't mean anything. And I was thinking, how profound is that? When my mother-in-law took her last breath, he was kind of wrapping, you know, their 45 years up into just a few moments. And he says, you know what? In layman's terms, when I think about our 45 years together, the money really doesn't really mean anything. That when it's all said and done right now, that money means absolutely nothing. So I'm taking it that they probably had a few arguments about money, a few discussions about money. But when it all boiled down, it wasn't about money. So when our lives all boil down to it, it can't be anything other than Jesus Christ. If it's about anything other than Jesus, it means nothing. It's meaningless, and one day all of us are going to be in some kind of hospital bed or some kind of accident that's going to take us to God. But when it boils all down to it, are we replacing godly things with earthly things? Think about this. We're all going to die. What? 80, maybe, if we're lucky, 90 years. But yet we've replaced this, all of these beautiful things that God has given us with things of this world. And this is causing Paul to weep because their mind isn't in the right place. Paul says in our next point is that they're earthly minded. That they're so focused on where they are right now that they're not preparing for where they're going to spend eternity. Those of you that are married, you spent what, maybe the average person, what, a year or so planning for your marriage, and maybe, what, a week on marriage counseling, if you chose to do that. You spent hours upon hours, hundreds of hours on picking out a dress and a cake and invitations and calligraphy and how all of these things are going to look. But most people spend this amount of time on having marriage counseling, pre-marriage counseling. You're spending all of this time on things that are fleeting. You know, we spend countless months and years planning for something, for an hour ceremony? Some of us are spending 10, 15 years on things that when it's all said and done aren't really gonna mean too much. So Paul is saying they're earthly minded in verse 19. They set their mind on earthly things. And this is disturbing Paul because they're missing out on the things of God. Now, we're obviously here on earth, we have to use things like gas and food. I'm not saying that. But he's saying that their affections are here. Like, this is it. And if this is it, that's sad. If this is all that life has to offer, man, what does the Bible say? We're to be pitied. If there's no resurrection, we're to be pitied. If this is all of life that God has for us, how sad is that? But the Apostle Paul is saying there's so much more for you. So much more than living for the pleasures of the body. You see, the people in Paul's day, there were legalists, and then there were those that were on the other side of the spectrum that said, well, now that my soul is saved, I can pretty much live however I want. So I can do whatever I want to do to my body, my flesh. It doesn't mean anything. And Paul had to address this issue in Corinth. And he says this in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. He says, flee sexual immorality. He says, every sin that a man does is outside the body, but he who commits sexual immorality sins against his own body. Verse 19, he says, or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? He's saying God is living inside you. You don't have a license to live any way you want. God is living inside of you. It says, of whom you have from God. It says, and you are not your own. Did you know that? You don't belong to you. You can't do whatever you want to do to yourself. You belong to God. Why? Listen to verse 20. It says, for you were bought at a price. Your salvation cost Jesus something. Thus, we shouldn't be able to do whatever we want. It's kind of like you get a, you know, maybe get all dressed up. You don't go outside and play in the mud. You want to take care of what you have, right? Well, we have been changed, renewed, redeemed, forgiven. The Bible says that Jesus is going to clothe us in his righteousness. Why would we go wallow around in the mud? We don't belong to ourselves. We need to treat ourselves like somebody did give their life for us, and Jesus did. So we should act different. And Paul is saying, you guys are going about this the wrong way. You're not to live to yourself, but you are to live unto God. And he gives us an example here, Jesus does in Matthew chapter 6. He says, do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys nor where thieves break in and steal. So you ladies with all of your armoires and china and precious little dolls and trinkets that no one can touch or look at, that's locked up in that little cabinet there, those are pretty for you, right? You love those things. They've been passed down. You cherish those things. Well, the next person you give it to, dust is going to collect on it, might get broken a little bit. They'll probably wind up boxing it up and putting it in the garage on a shelf. That's reality. The cars we have, the houses that we keep up, all of these wonderful things will be passed on to someone else. So the question is, what are we laying up in heaven? What treasures are we laying up in heaven? What are we doing for the kingdom's sake? Things that thieves won't break in and steal. Isn't that sad? All of the things we want in life, we have to worry about it getting broken or broken into. You get a new car or something, you're worrying about somebody scratching it. No matter what you get, you're worrying about somebody taking it. Just maybe Jesus wants us to have our focus on things of heaven and not things of earth. Well, lastly, Paul reminds us that we're not to forget. He says in verse 20, he says, for our citizenship is in heaven. Let us remind each other that we're just passing through, that all of these trials and tribulations that we're experiencing, they are going to pass away because we belong to another place, our citizenship. I looked up this word and it says that citizenship is the status of a person recognized under the custom or law as being a member of a state. So I was thinking about that. We are citizens of heaven. We belong to a different place, and the only passport we need is Jesus Christ. Amen? We belong to some other place other than this earth. So if we are citizens to heaven, just maybe we should live like we want to go there. Amen? We should live like, you know what, I'm tired of this earth. You ever flip on the TV and watch the news? Do you ever go, man, I'm kind of tired of seeing murder after murder, this after this, that after that, this thing after this thing. I wonder if we long to be with Jesus, if we just long for Jesus to come at 7:52, which is right now. That would be an awesome ending to our night tonight. Please, Lord, because Paul is reminding us that we should look up. He says, from which we eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. This word eagerly means an impatient longing. I'm impatiently longing for you, Jesus. I've been saved for 21 years, and the moment someone told me that Jesus was going to come back, I've been looking for him ever since. I'm ready. Lord, now would be good. Maybe today would be that day. I would love to see my kids grow older. I'd love to see some grandkids and all of that good stuff, but I'm ready to go. Jesus, I'm eagerly awaiting you. To be with you, Jesus, is my life's desire. Because think about this. No matter how much money we make, it's not going to bring us happiness. All of us could be debt-free right now. Are we going to have joy? No. It's just this endless thing. It's just like this endless cycle. So Paul is saying, I eagerly await Jesus Christ. I'm looking unto Jesus. I'm wanting him. I'm longing for him. So I want to encourage all of us. May God help us with our longings. May our longings not be to retire, although that would be a great thing. May our longings not be to pay off our house, although that would be a wonderful thing. May our longings be for Jesus first and Him alone, that if Jesus wants to come back tonight, if He wants to tarry for 5-10 more years, may our longing be for Him and for Him only. Jesus, help us. 1 Thessalonians, Paul says it like this. He says, "For the Lord Himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first, those that have already died, placing their faith in Jesus Christ." Then verse 17, it says, "Then we who are alive and remain, we shall be caught up together," this is us, "we shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord." Verse 18 is key. "Therefore, comfort one another with these words." So when things get really tough for you and you share your tough day with somebody, may we remind each other that one day, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 is going to come. We're just going to hear a trumpet, and then somehow we're all going to just be lifted up with Jesus Christ. We need to encourage one another. It says comfort one another with these words. So instead of comforting each other regarding things down here, let us give that eternal comfort that one day Jesus is going to call us and He's going to come for us. And that should comfort us so much so that that says, "Lord, this thing that I'm going through, it hurts, it's painful. But one day, Jesus, Your word is true and You are going to come for me." And not only come for me, but the Bible talks about this transformation. Listen to verse 21. It says, "Who also transform our lowly body that it may be conformed to His glorious body." I'm not sure about you, but whenever I've been down, I have to take this big exhale. It's like whenever I'm down here, I'm like, okay, wow, I have to get back up. My knees pop when I walk. My ankles pop. There is no way for me to sneak up on anybody because all you hear is pop, pop, crack, crack. And I've been down and just, there. See, there it is. That's my life. These are my knees. God's going to replace all of these things. Maybe you've got a bad back. You bend over and you're like this for a couple days. Maybe you've got some issues going on in your body. One day God is going to fix all of that. And how glorious is it going to be when our bodies are going to function right? They're not going to crack and popple. They're not going to do all of these things. They're not going to hurt. No more Motrin, no more icing. No more aches and pains, no more getting out of bed real slow. God's going to transform our bodies into Jesus' glorious body, His resurrected body. Think about that. That's waiting for you and me, this transformation of our bodies. What I love about God is that He doesn't just do something halfway. He sees it all the way to the end. He's like, "I'm going to save you. I'm going to transform you. I'm going to give you hope. I'm going to give you love. I'm going to transform your body, and then I'm going to take you to heaven with me." How wonderful it is that He's going to transform us. How wonderful, wonderful is this? Not only this, but it goes on to say in 1 Corinthians, it says, "In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye," that's that, just the battling of an eye, that little twinkle there. It says, "At the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible. And we shall be changed, for this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality." It's going to happen just like that. And may we long for this change. May we long for this corruptible thing to put on that thing that is incorruptible. The Bible talks about death being swallowed up in victory because of what Jesus Christ has done on the cross. Wonderful that we're going to be changed. Well, the latter part of verse 21, it says, "According to the working by which He is able even to subdue all things to Himself." What does that mean? Jesus can do whatever He wants to do. The Bible says He's got enough power. Jesus came and spoke to them saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth." That means He doesn't have to ask for permission for anybody. He can do whatever He wants. That means Jesus can change us, touch us, renew us, redeem us. He has the power to do that. But do you believe that? Do you believe that Jesus can look at your problem and say, I think I can fix that? Or do you think Jesus looks on your problem and say, wow, let me get back to you. I don't know how we're going to fix that. I need to talk to you a few guys back here, and man, I've never seen that problem before. Wow, good luck working that out. He's got enough power. All authority has been given unto Jesus. He can do anything. And I pray that we would be believers that would be willing to believe that Jesus can do even the impossible. Because the impossible was to save you, wasn't it? The impossible, because some of us know who we were before we met Jesus Christ. That was an impossible feat for God to change your heart and your life. But yet he did so because he has all power. I believe he's still in the business of changing people. Well, let me leave you with this. When packing for a trip, depending on where you're going, you pack certain clothes. If you're going to take a couple of days down in Mexico or a tropical cruise somewhere, you're not going to pack any pants. You're packing shorts and flip-flops, right? No big jackets and no boots. Well, family, we are heaven-bound. So I wonder, have you packed appropriately for your trip to heaven? So normally before you go on vacation, you have a small little checklist. Honey, darling, boyfriend, girlfriend. Well, you shouldn't be going on any trips with your girlfriend or boyfriend. So, honey, wife, and husband. Amen to that. Amen to that. Thank you, Jesus. We do things the right way. So you ask your husband or your wife, do we have everything? Let's go down the checklist. We have this, we have this, we have this, we have this. Oh, we forgot that. So let's go down our heavenly checklist before we check out of here. Number one, is your heart free of idols? Of all of the things that vie for your love and attention, is your heart free of all of those things that we have placed greater than Jesus? Are our affections for these things in its wrong place? Number two, is your heart divided? Are you holding on tightly to earthly things? Where is your treasure at tonight? Thirdly, is there unforgiveness that you're holding on to? Because God doesn't want us carrying any bags of unforgiveness where we're going. So I want to encourage you, if you're going through some unforgiveness, and yes, you were probably wronged, and yes, it's their fault, but God holds you responsible for what you do with that. You can hold on, keep rehearsing it in your mind, and that can make you feel alive or whatever it does for you, but God will want you to leave that bag here on earth. And if that's you, you should leave that bag here tonight. Number four, are you excited to see the Lord? Is that on your checklist? Or do you have a few other things you want to accomplish in this thing called life? And then lastly, would Jesus agree that he is your treasure? It's easy for us to say that, but would Jesus agree? Yeah, I am your treasure. Or would Jesus say, come on now, stop playing around. You have all of these other things in front of me. Think about that. Take a serious look. Would Jesus say that he is your treasure? Or there are a couple other things that you have in front of him. What we love to do tonight is we're just going to pray. We're going to worship a little bit. And if Jesus isn't your treasure, A, God already knows that. Do something about that. If you're holding on to a few of the earthly things, if you're being earthly minded instead of heavenly minded, as Paul talked about tonight, just fix that. God, help me. Help me to love you. I think God is big enough to take that prayer. God, I don't love you the way I should. Help me with that. Better we do that than we kind of go through the motions of pretending. So God, help me in my walk with you. Amen.